Good afternoon, everybody who has joined us online for this webinar. We are in the series of Geobefikar Women webinars. This is our fourth webinar, and thank you so much for everybody who has joined us live on the website geobefikarwomen.com. Our seminar topic today is breast cancer awareness. We are celebrating Pink October. We have been doing a series of activities on our Twitter channel on geobefikarwomen.com. And in a continuation of this series, we will be doing this webinar. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining in. My name is Ajay Das Gupta. I will be the facilitator for this workshop. And let me quickly take you through who all we have on this on the panel of speakers today. Very excited that we have some very eminent people from the field of research and study and surgery on breast cancer. First on our list is Dr. Anupama. She's a young and dynamic surgeon specializing in breast oncosurgery, and she's actively involved in spreading awareness about breast cancer. She arranges special screen camps and is an integral part of the Breast Friends Support Group Pune. Dr. Anupama, thank you so much for being with us today on this webinar.
Thanks for having me here, and a very good afternoon to everybody.
Thanks, Dr. Anupama. We will come back to you, Dr. Anupama, a little later when she takes us through a series of technical details about breast cancer and what we should know. Moving on, we also have Dr. Rama Shivaram. She's a health educator, counselor, and patient advocate. A special thanks to Dr. Rama Shivaram for being here on this webinar today. Let me just remind our participants and our viewers that she is also a breast cancer survivor, and we will look forward for some stories that she can share with us. She advocates both at the national and international level for health rights for patients. Dr. Rama, thank you so much for being on this webinar with us today.
Hi, good afternoon. It's my pleasure to be here.
Thanks, Dr. Rama. We move on to our third panel member. We have a psycho-oncologist, Rebecca. Rebecca, hi.
Hi.
Rebecca has this vast experience in training young people, talking about life skills. She also works regularly, conducts workshops and training programs for parents, teachers, and children on various life management skills. She works with cancer patients and their families in their adjustment to the disease. Thank you so much, Rebecca, for being on the show today.
You're welcome. It's a pleasure.
Okay, so very quickly for our viewers, right now we have about roughly about 45 or 50 people who have already joined us live, and people are connecting as we speak. Very quickly to all our participants and viewers, we have a calling and dial-in number. It's 022-660-8555. You can just dial in into this number, use the participant pin, which is 811-850#. We will take your calls throughout this webinar. We also have a Twitter handle. Please use the hashtag GeobefikarWomen, #GeobefikarWomen to tweet. You can also ask your questions in the chat window, and you could also direct your queries to the email address provided here, healconsultancy@gmail.com. Very quickly, this is how our participants and viewers' screen looks like. You can use the chat window to ask us questions. And as I said, there are awards for the three best tweets using the key insights from this webinar. You need to tweet, and we will be giving out prizes to the three best tweets. Just remember to use the hashtag #GeobefikarWomen. A very quick note about our website. It's geobefikarwomen.com. We already have about 26,000 people on our Facebook channel. It's facebook.com/geobefikarwomen. Okay, so moving on to Dr. Anupama. Dr. Anupama, we are going to talk about this entire topic of from awareness to action, risks, detection, and treatment. Yeah, so Dr. Anupama, over to you, and I'm moving to the first slide now. Dr. Anupama.
Yeah, thanks, Ajay. We'll just discuss the risks of breast cancer. Breast cancer, as you might be knowing, is one of the most common malignancies, cancers in women. It's the most common cause of death amongst women aged 40 to 50. As you can see in this graph, the age group 40 to 50, they are most under threat of dying from breast cancer. The risk of getting breast cancer is not the highest in this group, but the risk of dying is the highest in this group.
Yeah,
Next slide, please.
Yeah, so Dr. Bruno, what we are saying is that even if you are not in the age group of 40 to 50, even then you should take precautions, you should be aware.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
The youngest case that I have seen of breast cancer has been a 16-year-old girl.
Okay.
And of course, as age increases, the risk increases, so we get plenty of women in the older age group. But 40 to 50 is a very, very vulnerable age group. And women all across the ages have to be cautious and careful about this.
Okay. So
the next slide.
Yeah.
This shows cancer sites in women in rural India. This is a registry, cancer registry from the area of Barshi in Maharashtra. As you can see from this bar graph, the lowest bar showing the cancer of the cervix, that shows the maximum incidence, and breast is second. This is from rural India, whereas from urban India, the next slide please.
Yeah.
Next slide shows that in urban India, the breast cancer has overtaken cervical cancer, cancer of the cervix. This is mainly due to urbanization of the lifestyle. The rural women, they get married early, they have many children, they breastfeed for a longer time. All these reduce the risk of breast cancer. Whereas the urban women, they get married late, they have less number of children, maybe no children. They can't breastfeed for a longer time because they have to join back their work and employment. All these are reasons and risks for increasing breast cancer incidence amongst urban India, basically.
So,
and in fact, earlier, CA cervix was known as the most common, but now overall, breast cancer has become the most common cancer in females.
Okay. So what we are seeing here is that there is a definite evidence that lifestyle changes is leading to greater number of breast cancer cases.
Absolutely.
Okay.
There's no doubt. Yeah. Next slide shows the risk of one woman in 22 women in urban India getting breast cancer, and in rural India it is 1 in 60. So you can see the large difference amongst urban women and rural women. And as per the National Cancer Registry, there is an increasing incidence of breast cancer at the rate of 1.8% per year. 1.8 as such seems a very small number, but because of the high density of population in India, it actually translates into a very large number of women getting breast cancer every year.
Yeah. This is a very interesting, and it just shows us the severity of this disease affecting women in urban life settings today.
Absolutely. And one important point I want to make about this, the next slide, that if you see this pie diagram, in the Western countries, out of all the women who get breast cancer, 75% survive, they are cured, they do very well, while 25% die. That's almost one-fourth people dying of breast cancer, whereas in India, almost half of them die of breast cancer. And the main reason for this is late detection.
Okay.
Because women are not aware of the signs and symptoms, they are not aware of regular health checkups, when the health checkup should be done and what should be done, usually they come to the clinics very late. They meet the doctors very late, the disease is advanced, and then it becomes very difficult to save their lives. And that is actually the purpose of having this webinar or, you know, breast cancer awareness programs. We want to empower the women, make them aware that they should get the lumps or symptoms detected early, they should come for regular checkup, and in case there is a cancer, it can get detected early and be completely cured. Please remember that early breast cancers are totally curable.
Okay. So we will come back to this topic. This is a very interesting topic about awareness and asking women to come out openly, do checkups, and which drastically reduces the cases of complications. Let's move on from here. So the risk factors.
Yeah, the most important risk factor, as I mentioned earlier, is age. increase in age of the women increases the risk for breast cancer. That means it is more common in the older age group, above 50, 60 years of age. Then length of reproductive life. The longer the menstrual cycles last, the more is the risk. That means if a lady has early menarche and late menopause, she is at a higher risk for breast cancer. Age of first childbirth, if it's very early or if it's late, more than 35 years, that also has been found in many clinical studies to increase the risk. Nulliparity. Nulliparity means having no children, not even conceiving or abortions. These women also have a higher risk. Heredity is an important cause, but only in about 5% of the women. A family history, that means a genetic mutation in the genes BRCA1 and 2, can lead to breast cancer. And of course, breast disease is caused by high fat diet, high dose, duration of hormone replacement therapy, which women take after menopause, or even longer use of oral contraceptive pills. Obesity, alcohol, and stress are the other factors which are related to urban lifestyle and increase the risk of breast cancer.
Dr. Anupama, this is a very interesting list of items, and I just want to reiterate this to everybody who's viewing, and also a question, is that what we are saying is that there is a high correlation between these lifestyle changes and the occurrence of breast cancer, but we are not saying that this is a cause and effect. You know, it's not that if you do not have children, you are, you're at a higher risk. It's correlated, but it's not a cause and effect.
No, it is not a cause and effect. In fact, there is no definite known cause.
Okay. So, because we also are for women to make their career choices and, take their lifestyle decisions themselves. So, a small advice here is that all of these are correlated to cancer, breast cancer cases, and not a cause and effect.
Okay. It means that the women, any woman who has any of these risk factors needs to be more aware. That's all.
Okay, perfect. I have another question here. And, how do I know if I have a hereditary disposition towards a BRCA1 or a BRCA2 mutation? Or I have a mutated gene? I mean, it's very difficult for me to know that I have it.
So it's the family history. If any blood relation in the family is having breast cancer or ovarian cancer,
okay,
that is the first. So if you have no family history, then you don't really need to worry about this gene.
Okay.
And if you have a family history, then there is a simple blood test which can detect BRCA1 and 2 mutations.
Okay. So a woman can walk into a hospital and say, I want to get a BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutation test done.
She can do that, but it's not very easily available. In India, it's available in just 3 to 4 centers.
Okay.
So it's a very expensive test. It costs more than 50,000 rupees per test.
Okay.
So this is actually a little controversial. We can't really go into details of this, but you need genetic counseling before doing this test. Because what happens is if a woman tests positive for BRCA1 or 2, it does not mean that she will definitely have cancer. Or if a woman does not test positive, she's negative for these genes, it does not mean that she will develop cancer or she will not develop. So, these are, again, as I said, just correlating risk factors. These do not mean that woman will develop it.
Sure. Thanks. Let's move on from there then. So we are talking about symptoms and early detection now. And for our viewers, the presentation contains graphical content and illustrations, and we would ask for viewers' discretion for viewing these slides that come up ahead. So over to Dr. Anupama again.
Okay, the first and the most important sign that women should look out for is any new lump or hard knot found in the breast or the armpit. Please remember that armpit is also a very important area. Breast cancer can start in the armpit also without any lump being there in the breast. Another important thing is any new lump or thickening in the breast that does not shrink or lessen after the next period. Usually due to normal hormonal changes, before periods, many women get nodularities in the breast. These are not lumps. These are not cancers. These nodularities come and go along with the periods. So, before periods, the breast become congested, enlarged, swollen, tender, but all that reduces on the last day of the periods. So don't be worried about that. Don't panic if you feel any nodularity then. But keep a lookout. If after the periods are over, the lump does not shrink, does not go away, then you should consult a doctor.
Okay.
The next slide.
Yeah.
Any change in size, shape or symmetry of your breast? By that I mean that you should be aware of the normal size and shape of your breast. Only then you'll be able to make out if there is any other, any non-clinical size or shape or change in the breast. Any thickening, as I mentioned earlier, and any dimpling, puckering or indentation in the breast. As you can see in the lower diagram, there is no lump, but the skin is being pulled inside. Even that is a sign of a cancer being inside the breast, which is pulling the skin or causing dimpling of the skin.
Okay.
The next slide shows the changes in the nipple. Any redness, scaliness, or any non-healing ulcer, non-healing wound on the nipple or the skin around the nipple, on the areola also. Unexplained nipple tenderness, nipple retraction, any fluid or discharge from the nipple which is other than milky, particularly if it is bloody, dark, or occurs without squeezing the nipple. Women have to be aware that on pressing the nipples, both sides, many times there is a milky discharge, but this is normal. This is physiological. It does not indicate that there is disease. But if any discharge is spontaneous, it stains their clothes, underclothes, or it comes out from one duct or from one breast, then that is significant. That should be checked out by the doctor.
So for all our women viewers who are listening in, If you feel that any of these symptoms is something that you are experiencing, it's time to quickly do a checkup or go to the doctor, meet your doctor as soon as possible. Okay, let's move on from there.
Okay, the next slide shows a couple of photographs about the nipple discharge and nipple retraction. In cases of nipple retraction, I just want to make a point that some women have congenitally retracted nipples. That means from birth, they have nipples which are pulled inside. That is normal. That is nothing to worry about. But women who have a recent onset nipple retraction, that means that the nipples were normal, but recently, since last 10, 15 days or maybe a month or more, the nipples have gone inside without any lump being palpable. That is the important sign, and you should go to a doctor for a checkup.
Okay.
The next slide shows destruction of the nipple, a non-healing wound, basically. In spite of applying ointments or taking antibiotics, painkillers, if this does not heal, after taking medicines for a week or more, if this kind of condition does not heal, then you should consult an oncologist because this is also a sign of breast cancer.
Okay.
The next slide shows again a bloodstained nipple discharge, which is very significant. And the other picture shows a dimpling of the skin in the armpit. Can you see that? There is no lump visible or palpable by the lady, but the skin is pulled inside in the armpit. That also shows that there is some pathological process going inside the breast, which is causing this dimpling of the skin. So again, you should be aware of all these symptoms, not only a lump, but anything else, any abnormality in the breast, and go and get it checked up if you have anything.
Sure.
Next slide. Breast cancer diagnosis. Basically, when a patient comes to us, what do we do? The basic history, signs, symptoms, since how many days she's having the problem, any family history, as I mentioned, it's important to know that. Physical examination, the doctor is going to do inspection, that means just visually seeing, and palpation, that means checking for the breast lumps or masses, checking for the nipple discharge, checking in the armpits for any axillary nodal involvement, or any other changes basically, to check whether it is breast cancer, first of all, and whether it has spread to any organs, that's secondly.
Okay, I have a question which has come in from a viewer from Twitter. Shrikant,
yeah.
Thank you for asking that question. Shrikant has a question. He says, what is the biggest risk factor for breast cancer?
Age.
Okay.
Age is a risk factor for all cancers, including breast cancer.
Okay.
But in younger women, breast cancer is more common in hereditary cases. So in some families in which BRCA1 and 2 mutations are very, very common, in that case, we see younger women getting it. But otherwise, in general population, sporadic cases, age is the most common and most important risk factor which cannot be changed.
Okay. Okay. Srikant, I hope that answers your question, and let's move on from there.
Okay, the next slide shows us what we do in cases of breast lumps for diagnosis. This is a test known as a mammography. It's a special X-ray of the breast. As you can see, the lady is standing in front of the X-ray machine, and the breast is placed on the X-ray plate, and a little bit of compression is given to spread out the breast tissue. This compression causes a little discomfort and pain, but it's very mild. It lasts for just 2 to 3 seconds each breast, and we get a very clear picture, X-ray of the breast, showing the lumps inside. If you can see the circles in the center of the slide, the biggest circle on the top, the pink circle, this is just to give you an estimation of the importance of mammography actually. The biggest circle represents the average size lump found by a woman practicing occasional breast self-examination. That means a lady who's not really very aware and just one fine day observes this huge big lump. The second circle, pink circle, shows the average size lump found by a woman practicing regular breast self-examination. That means a lady who's more aware is able to detect the lump earlier when it's a smaller size. The third small circle shows the average size lump found by the first mammogram. That means that the woman goes for a screening checkup. She does not feel any lump. She goes for a mammogram, and that is the size of lump that can be picked up. And the last small circle, the smallest one, shows the average size lump found by getting regular mammograms. This is also not felt or palpable by the lady. So you can see the importance of getting regular mammograms. If you get it once every 2 years after the age of 40 years, then this small cancer can be picked up. By the time this cancer actually grows into something that is felt by the hand or even by the doctor, this has already been in the body for a long time. So that's the importance of screening mammography. All women above the age of 40 years should go for a screening mammography.
I have a quick question here. Is that one of our viewers has had raised this question on our online forum once, is that mammography includes some radiation risks. So is that true? Is that true? Can, you know, repeated radiation risk, you know, radiation itself lead to cancerous conditions?
It does have a little bit of radiation, but the radiation is much less than what you would get in sunlight if you stay out in the heat for more than 2 hours.
Okay.
So it's that less radiation in one exposure of mammography. And mammography that we recommend is once in 2 years at least. So that's very minimal radiation. It does not really lead to breast cancer.
Okay. Okay. Thanks for answering that question. Let's move on.
The next slide also shows the mammography, how it's done, and how a normal breast looks like, and how a dense breast looks like. This is the reason, actually, the density of the breast, this is the reason why we don't do mammography or we don't advise mammography in younger women. Because younger women have glandular tissue and very dense breasts. So it's very easy to miss cancers on mammography in younger women. Whereas the older women, they have very fatty breasts, the glandular tissue has regressed, their breastfeeding is over. According to age, they have very fatty breasts. So it's easier to pick up cancers in older women.
Okay.
So actually I see many women who come to the clinic in their 20s and 30s and, you know, they want to do mammography. But it's not advisable in the younger age group. It's advisable only above 40 years.
Okay. So a blanket advice: if you are a young woman, mammography is not advisable because of the natural density of the breast muscles and the structure.
That's right.
Okay.
You can appreciate this fact in the next slide. The next slide shows the mammogram. The right-sided picture shows a small density over there, which is a cancer. The left-sided is normal. So if you have a mammogram like this, you can pick up, but as you saw the previous slide, if you have a dense breast, you can't pick up this cancer. It's very difficult. So there's no point doing a mammogram in the younger age group.
Okay.
Then after mammogram, what we do is something known as FNAB or FNAC, which is fine needle aspiration biopsy or cytology. It's a very simple test done in the outpatient department only. We put in a small needle and syringe, take out a few cells from the lump, put it on the slide and send it to the pathologist in the lab. The pathologist checks all these cells and tells us whether these are cancerous cells or they are not. So it's a very small little test just one needle prick and we come to know what the nature of the lump is. And in case we don't get enough samples, sometimes it happens that the cells are very less. In that case, we need to do a core biopsy or even an excision biopsy. Excision means removal of the lump. So once we have more tissue, we can definitely say whether it is cancerous or not. So these are two basic tests which women need to undergo if they have any lump, the mammography and the FNAC.
Okay, so I'm guessing that these are more. This is a more advanced detection methodology only if you have some kind of an evidence or you're thinking that there is something, then only a biopsy is recommended.
That's right.
Okay. All right. So let's move on. I'm getting very good questions all from everybody and reminding our viewers, please call us on the numbers given here. Use the hashtag. We've got another very interesting question that has come up. Dr. Anupama, I would like to take you direct this question to you, and then I have another question which I'll direct to the other panel members. But first, mm-hmm. Dr. Anupama, this question is for you. Why are mutation tests so expensive and inaccessible? And any other alternatives? And I'm just thinking that, Rebecca, Dr. Rama, you also work in this field. We just saw that the main mutation test is expensive. What could be the other alternatives?
There is no current alternative right now. Mutation tests are expensive because they are testing your genetic material. There are thousands and thousands of genes which need to be checked. I don't know the exact way how they do these tests, but they are expensive all over the world.
Okay.
And they have been introduced very recently. I guess as time goes on, more and more hospitals, more and more laboratories will take up these tests, more samples, and naturally that decreases the cost. But that's going to take some years at least.
Okay, I have a question for Dr. Rama. Dr. Rama, there is a very interesting question that has come up. Is that on Twitter, Ronnie has asked this question through Twitter. Do you think, as urban women are more prone, do you think that HR departments of companies should hold more sessions for women to become aware of this disease and its repercussions and how to become more aware of it?
Yes. In fact, the more responsibility the HR people take, I think it is not only going to show that they have an empathy towards women and women's health issues, but more importantly, one must also realize that the women themselves, if they are healthy, the production rate, everything else, the profits, the economic growth, everything is maintained. The moment a woman falls sick and she is employed and there is nothing, that she can do about, then it's difficult for her and for the organization. Most importantly, awareness means early detection. And I think it's a corporate social responsibility that their own employees are first made aware of the situation and how to seek the right kind of help for it.
Okay. Thanks. So, clear message to, that HR departments, personnel departments should run awareness camps for women so that they can become more aware of this. There are a lot of questions coming in, but another question that I want to direct to Dr. Anupama is, what is the, Simran has asked this question, Simran Saini through the chat window, she's asking this question, what is the comparison of chances of breast cancer in fertile women to that of infertile women?
I assume by fertile you mean that women who've had children, and infertile means who've not had children. The risk is definitely more in the women who've not conceived, who've not had children. It's very difficult to quantitate how much risk is more. But several studies have shown when they've checked the breast cancer patients and the normal women, they've seen that women who've not had children or not breastfed their children are at a higher risk. But it's very difficult to give a quantitative estimation that whether it increases the risk by 10%, 20%, 30%. That's really not possible.
Okay. Thanks. Simran, I hope that answered your question. Let's move on now. We are going to quickly remind everybody that we are running the Twitter contest. 3 best tweets win. All that you need to do is take a key insight from today's webinar and tweet using the hashtag #GeoBefikarWomen. And also remember to follow @BajajAllianz. Okay, moving on. This is a very interesting topic on breast self-examination. Over to you, Dr. Anupama, once again.
This is very important. I think this is the most important part of this whole webinar. If women can learn to do the breast self-examination properly, correctly, they will be really, really empowered. So first thing is when to do it, the last day of the periods for the premenopausal ladies. This is important because before periods, as I mentioned earlier, the breasts are enlarged, swollen, congested, and more nodular. So it's difficult to pick up the lumps. So the best time would be the last day of the period, maybe the fifth day or the sixth day. And for the postmenopausal ladies who don't have their periods now, first of every month or any other date, but a fixed day of every month. This has to be done only once every month. Please don't do it every day or very frequently because then you will not be able to pick up minor changes. Do this only once every month.
Okay.
And this is the way to do it. Very simple method, nothing too complicated. Just stand in front of the mirror. This is known as inspection. Just visually inspect the breasts. See how they look like. Please be aware that normally, in about 95% of the women, there is a discrepancy in the size and shape of both the breasts. That is normal. Don't get worried about that, that one breast is smaller or bigger than the other. Just be sure what is normal for you. So just look at the size, the shape, the contour, the nipple, the areola, all the region around it. Next, raise your hands above. See whether both the nipples, areolas and breasts move up to the same degree. If one breast moves up with raising the hands and the other one does not, that means the one which does not has a problem inside. So though you may not be feeling a lump inside, but there's some problem inside that breast which is preventing it to move up when the hands are raised up. Next, get your hands down, press on your waist. When you press like this on your waist, your pectoralis muscle, the chest wall muscle, that gets taut and the breasts become more prominent. You'll be able to see this yourself. So again, what you have to look for is symmetry in both the breasts, that both of them are becoming prominent to the same degree. If one remains loose, one becomes more prominent, or there is a difference in the degree in which they are becoming prominent, then there is a problem. You need to go to the doctor and get it checked out. After that is palpation. Palpation means feeling the breast with your fingers. Lie down on a bed in a comfortable position. Opposite hand and opposite breast, you have to use that. Don't use the tips of your fingers. Use the palmar surface of the fingers. Don't use the palm. Palm is not very sensitive. You have to use your fingers, three fingers basically, the ring, the middle, and the index finger. Use the palmar surface, make small circles on the breast as is shown in the diagram, and move the fingers all over the breast, trying to feel for a lump. A lump would usually feel as hard as a stone. That is a cancerous lump. Of course, there can be other small nodularities which you will notice, but that's okay. Just be aware that they are your normal nodularities. Don't panic if you find something. Just be aware of what it is. When you keep doing this thing repeatedly, you'll come to know what is normal for you. So as I said, opposite hand and opposite breast. And please don't forget the armpit. You have to check in your armpit also. And lastly, check for the nipple discharge also. So okay. This inspection and palpation is going to be able to tell you whether you have any abnormality in your breast. And do it once every month. If you find any abnormality occurring at any time, then you have to go and consult a doctor.
Okay. Thanks, and you know, it appears to be so simple that you can just do this at home, as Dr. Mane said, fix a date and a particular date of the calendar when you do it, so that you can find out those discrepancies. I have a question for Rebecca, who is also in the room. She works a lot with younger people, and one of the questions that I have for you, Rebecca, is that how do we do you think that people are open to discussing about breast self-examination? You know, have you found out that, the awareness is growing? What are the typical mindsets and taboos that are associated with this entire disease, which is stopping us from, spreading the message farther?
Ajay, because we do not know the cause of cancer and we are not sure of whether there is a cure, there's a big stigma attached to it.
That's
and
right.
In my experience, I have found that, younger women who whose mothers or aunts or, you know, in the relation, if there is somebody who has been diagnosed with cancer, then they automatically get more empowered, they're more aware, they want to be in charge, they want to take control.
Yeah.
But if I don't know anybody who has got cancer, I mean, I have no relative, I have no friend, I have nobody, then it really doesn't concern me. It's a very normal reaction to most of us. Unless it's in our vicinity, then we are more prone, we are more alert, we are more aware, and we want more information. But if it doesn't affect me, then I'm really not interested because it's nothing to do with me right now. And just to reiterate what Dr. Mani says, most of us, we forget that in breast cancer, the lumps don't pain. There is no pain associated. There is no hurt. So, and human tendency is that we will visit the doctor when it is associated with pain.
Yeah.
So I think just to add on to what Dr. Mani has been talking about, that to know that there is a difference in the lumps and to go to the right place at the right time. And younger women, we are not so interested unless it is, we are connected to it.
Yeah.
I hope that answers.
Yeah. And do you also think that there needs to be a wider discussion at home, mother, daughter, in schools, teacher and girl students, or even in colleges, more public seminars about this? Because it seems to me that the early detection is really the only method of, you know, fighting this thing.
Ajay, I'd just like to say is that all information has to be tapered according to the understanding and the age of a child.
Okay.
It's just like how we are teaching younger kids to be more aware of abuse. It is a way of talking about it. Same thing, I think, in terms of breast health. Information has to be according to the age of the child. And definitely in some of the schools that I have been associated with, they have been talking to their girl children, the girl students, about taking care of their bodies, understanding their bodies. That's most important. Is in our experience, we have seen women coming in and not knowing that one breast was bigger than the other from before. So knowing yourself, knowing your body, how it looks, that's the first step. And I think that we can do at schools up to some level. But most importantly, I think it has to be done at home with mothers. So mothers and daughters together have a more better role to play.
Yeah. I think it needs to start at the home. It needs to start between the mother and daughter, the conversations that are happening there. We need to be able to go across to the mothers and say that, you know, if you can make your daughters more aware at an early age, then they would be more particular about doing this throughout their life.
But just to remind you, for that, the mothers have to be aware.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Okay. Moving on from there, there is a one interesting question that has come, and I'll direct that to Dr. Anupama. I don't know if we can answer this question directly, but there is a question on the chat window from Babita, who is saying that I have a lump under my right armpit, which is almost 18 years old. There is no growth in the lump, yet it pains when pressed. Surgeon advises no surgery, but checkups after every 6 months. What would be your advice to Babita?
The fact that the lump has been there since so many years, it is not increasing in size, and the previous checkups have said that it is normal, there's nothing to worry about.